Joining me to discuss this are the art critic Estelle Lovett and the journalist Melanie McDonough. Let me go to Estelle first. Would you pay £13,000 for this?
Well, I don't think that's really the question. The question is, I think this sculpture will do more for the Church of England than Henry VIII did. I think it will get more people in through the doors, especially at this time of Lent coming up to Easter. And I think the way that we view it is to consider what our lives are all about, and our perceptions will illustrate this image of Christ on the cross as being one of us. You know, if somebody fantastic as Constable could be considered blasphemous for including a church in his landscape, there's something wrong in the way that we're seeing art.
Right. And Melanie McDonough, what do you think?
Well, of course, Estelle is right that we need to see ourselves in terms of the suffering Christ, because in theological terms he died for all of us. So the title of the piece, For Pete's Sake, is in a theological sense quite correct, in that Christ, of course, did die for Pete Doherty, like he died for everybody. The question is whether, as an abnormal crucifix, as an abnormal crucifixion, we look beyond the image on the cross to Christ himself, or do we stop short at Pete Doherty? And I think for a lot of the people who are going to look at it, they will stop short at Pete Doherty and see the celebrity, and they won't look beyond it to that which a cross is meant to represent. If it had been done differently, if, for instance, a homeless man had been depicted on the cross with Pete Doherty kneeling in veneration before it, that might have made an equally powerful point without actually that element of vainglory with Doherty as bigger or as great as Christ.
Melanie, let's stay with you. The fact that the artist has used criticism from the media, from newspaper articles and other sources, and adorned the cross itself with that, does that have an accurate echo, if you like, with the Easter story?
Well, impetus for the piece was Pete Doherty's crucifixion at the hands of the media. I'm afraid that's not quite in the same league as the story of the Passion, where Christ dies for the sins of man. But in that sense, that we all contribute, in a sense, to the Passion by virtue of Christ dying for all our sins, that is legitimate. But as I say, the danger of this piece is that you don't look beyond it to Jesus Christ, you just look as far as Pete Doherty, and it tends to that element of glorifying Pete Doherty rather than making us think about the sins that put Christ on the cross.
Yes, Estelle Lovett, it's hardly a like for like, is it?
Well, you know, a lot of people aren't going to look at this piece and think, oh, is that exactly what Pete Doherty looks like? I think what it is a very clever piece, a very clever pun on with names and with words, there's no doubt about that. But it's not offensive. You know, if you consider pieces of artwork like Serrano's Crucifixion in a bowl, in a tank of urine, if you consider the fact that, why is it okay for Obama to be depicted as Christ, or David Bowie even to be depicted as Christ? Why is it okay for the Vatican Art Gallery to have Francis Bacon and Picasso's images of Christ there? You know, this is a beautiful piece of art, and as I said, if it gets more people walking through the church doors at this time, it's done a good job and Christ would be pleased.
But it's actually not about advertising Christianity or the Easter story, is it? It's about the needs of the people who are trying to support this man who's disappeared.
But that's what the money's being raised for, to raise funds to look for this young man that has disappeared, yes. But, you know, the story of Christ and the Passion of Christ is within all of us, and it's very interesting what the other guest said in terms of why not have a homeless person. When Damien Hirst went into collaboration with David Bailey and produced a set of images of the Passion of Christ and used the likes of supposedly homeless people, some people also found that blasphemous and offending. And if we think back to Je suis Charlie, you know, this is not what art is supposed to be about. Before art galleries, art was seen in the church. So the Pope or the Reverend was the first art critic, if you like, and it's great to see contemporary art back there now again.
Yeah, but if you take the Je suis Charlie, the whole point about that, surely, is very few other mediums, apart from that one magazine, decided to reproduce their imagery because of its difficulty and likely to cause offence. Melanie McDonough, I mean, does art have a right? Of course, artists have a right to offend if they want to, but is that a cheap shot on their behalf?
Yes, to an extent. I think it's very legitimate to draw a very sharp distinction between Christianity and Islam. Christ became man, God became man, and in that sense, it's absolutely fine to use living human models for Christ. That in itself isn't a problem, because it's, as Estelle says, it's always happened. But where it is a problem, if indeed David Bowie was the model for Christ, if you have David Bowie up there on the crucifix, is that you don't actually have that sense of the sacred. Instead, you have the glorification of celebrity. You don't have celebrity pointing to something larger than itself, namely to the divinity of Christ, which is, and on, in suffering humanity, which is what the crucifixion is meant to be about. So it becomes about Pete Doherty, about celebrity, rather than about the religious significance of the thing. But it is absolutely legitimate to use a human model to represent Christ, because that's been the tradition of certainly the Catholic element of Christianity for its entire history.
So Estelle Lovett, is it the weaker piece because the artist chose to feature Pete Doherty?
Is it the what piece? Sorry.
The weaker. Have they lost the point of their argument? Is it weaker
because they
chose him?
No, not at all. It doesn't matter. What makes it relevant to today and to a lot of people is the fact that it is a celebrity. So they can realise that Christ still lives on today. And it's not just that we see these gory, very bloody, very scary looking paintings that Caravaggio did of Christ, even that Rubens did of Christ. You know, Rubens painted Christ green, rotting. You know, this is a very beautiful, white, pure, life-size image, and I think it should stay there, actually.
But Melanie McDonough, we're being invited to compare the suffering of Christ as recorded in the Bible, if you accept that account, with the suffering of Pete Doherty, aren't we?
Yes, that's the problem. In one sense, canon, the vicar of St. Mary Lebon, is quite right that, we've all got to apply the Passion story to ourselves. But there is a danger when you use a celebrity that it is actually a diminishing element, and that there's an element of bathos about comparing Pete Doherty's treatment at the hands of the media to Christ's treatment at the hands of the Roman soldiers who crucified him and left him to die an agonising death. There's absolutely nothing wrong with depicting that agonising death. I mean, it's all there in the Gospels. And in a sense, Rubens and every other Christian artist did his best to portray exactly that, the sheer excruciating agony of the cross, which this doesn't. It's a very placid image. But I do think that trying to compare his vicissitudes with the media, however dreadful they were, with the Passion of the Lord, is actually to diminish the latter.
Estelle, a final thought from you?
I don't think we are in any way to compare Pete Doherty to Christ. We are to compare ourselves and our lives to Christ. And thank goodness we're talking about art and the church.
Estelle Lovett, Melanie McDonough, thank you both very much.